Welcome to Advances in Allergy and Asthma, a webinar series presented by Allergy and Asthma Network in partnership with the American College of Allergy, Asthma, and Immunology. This is Sally Schessler, Director of Education for Allergy and Asthma Network. Our webinar series helps Allergy and Asthma Network live out our mission to end the needless death and suffering due to asthma, allergies, and related conditions through outreach, education, advocacy, and research. We are joined today by Dr. Marissa Shams as she reviews urticaria for us in some depth with thoughts about dealing with this condition. Dr. Shams joined the allergy and immunology practice at the Emory Clinic in the fall of 2014. She attained her Bachelor of Science degree in biology, honors magna cum laude at the University of Georgia. She graduated from medical school at Mercer University School of Medicine and completed her internal medicine residency at Tulane University Hospital in New Orleans, Louisiana. For her allergy and immunology fellowship, she attended Emory University School of Medicine and subsequently joined the faculty as an assistant professor within the Department of Medicine, Division of Pulmonary, Allergy, and Critical Care and Sleep Medicine. Her clinical focus is in providing comprehensive allergy and immunology care to patients in the Atlanta area, with specific interests in urticaria and allergic skin disease, allergy in the elderly, immunodeficiency, and asthma. She's very involved in the allergy immunology community nationwide. Currently, she is the American College of Allergy, Asthma, and Immunology Young Physician Section Representative to the American Medical Association, the college's Government Relations Committee, and Secretary Treasurer for Allergists for Israel, a nonprofit group focused on expanding allergy care in Israel. She was previously on the executive board of the college, and she was named one of the top 40 Jewish leaders under 40 in Atlanta in 2014 and 2017. She has presented a variety of research projects on the state, regional, and national level, and has conducted interviews with the Emory Magazine, Fox 5 News, radio, and the NBC Today Show. Outside of medicine, her interests include spending time with her husband and son, baking, traveling, and yoga. And she is an avid UGA Bulldog fan. Well, Dr. Shams, thank you so much for being with us today. We really look forward to your talk.
Thank you. Thank you. And good afternoon to everybody. Before we get started, I just want to go ahead and thank the Allergy and Asthma Network, as well as the American College of Allergy, Asthma, and Immunology for having me present on this topic today. So without any further ado, I have no disclosures. I do intend to discuss some unapproved and investigative use of therapeutics in my presentation. Our objectives today are to compare and contrast the presentation and evaluation of acute and chronic urticaria, to describe the step-up approach for management of chronic urticaria, including that of special populations, and to implement a guideline-directed approach to management as well as consideration of alternative agents in patients with refractory cases. So, what is urticaria? So, before we can know what chronic urticaria is, we have to know what urticaria and angioedema are. So, urticaria is the presentation of wheals with central swelling and reflex erythema. These lesions occur of variable shape and size. Again, there is surrounding erythema. They're very pruritic, and generally these lesions fade within 24 to 48 hours. Commonly, they're referred to as whelps or hives. Angioedema is a non-pruritic, painful swelling that occurs deeper in the dermis. It can range from erythematous to flesh-colored. It's non-pitting, it lacks the well-defined margins we see with urticaria, and generally has a longer resolution period, and it can occur in 40 to 50% of our chronic urticaria patients. So when you see these patients in the office, you want to have a mindset of what questions to ask, so that will help delineate what diagnostic algorithm you need to pursue. So you want to know the onset of the disease. When did they start having these skin manifestations? What do they look like? What size are they? What shape are they? How often do they occur, and how long do they last? And what's the body surface area involvement? If they have photos, that's the best. And in this day and age, when everyone has a camera phone, photos are fantastic. You want to ask about associated symptoms. Is there any angioedema? are there any systemic complaints? Are these lesions induced by physical agents or exercise? And we'll get to that a little bit later. Is there any relationship to onset of menstrual cycle, food ingestion, drug ingestion? Is there any relationship with infection or stress? What previous therapies have they tried and how well have they worked? And also what previous evaluations have been done in the past? So we define acute urticaria as urticaria that persists for less than 6 weeks in duration. You can see that patients may have recurrent episodes if they're re-exposed to the same trigger. So these episodes are either IgE or non-IgE mediated triggers. So an example of IgE mediated triggers would be a food allergy, medication allergy. If someone breaks out with urticaria after receiving their immunotherapy or allergy shot. And the way that we would identify the culprit in this situation would be to use ELISA-based immunoassays or skin testing. Acute urticaria can also be due to non-IgE mediated causes. One of the most common is viral and etiology. Patients may also have contact urticaria where they are exposed to a contact allergen and that causes a urticaria presentation or ingestion of toxins. And one of the classic examples would be strombolic poisoning where a patient actually ingests spoiled darkly fleshed fish and that causes an increased histamine reaction to occur within the body. If you're seeing a patient with acute urticaria, you want to make sure that you assess for systemic complaints because you do not want to miss a case of anaphylaxis. Chronic urticaria, in contrast, is defined as urticaria persisting most days of the week for longer than 6 weeks in duration. It can be reoccurring or periodic, so it may be persistent or it may present for several months and then go away and then return several months later. If you have a patient that has urticaria for less than 6 weeks in duration, but they have features suggesting it may progress to longer, you do want to see them back more frequently in the clinic. Like I said previously, it can occur with angioedema, it can occur with systemic illness, and it's generally thought to be due to mast cell or basophil activation. Excuse me. The reason why we came up with 6 weeks, it's kind of an arbitrary distinction between acute and chronic urticaria. But the reason for that is that the most common cause of acute urticaria and angioedema, especially in children, is actually of viral etiology. And so at 6 weeks in time, your immune system should have cleared that virus. And so the acute urticaria related to viral etiology should have resolved. Within chronic urticaria prevalence. So we know that within the United States, previous studies have documented the prevalence rate at 0.23%. However, globally, it's been estimated to range anywhere from 0.08% up to 3%. Women are affected twice as often as men. And in regards to age-specific prevalence, we do have some discrepancies across the globe. In the United States, middle age is reported as the highest age-specific prevalence, but Korea, there was a recent study from Korea that showed that those with advanced age actually had the highest age-specific prevalence in their population. Generally,
every once in a while, you're fading in and out a little bit. So if you could make sure that you're as close to your microphone as you can be, that would be fabulous.
Okay, Thank you. Sorry about that.
No sure. problem.
So the duration is anywhere from 2 to 5 years, and up to 50%, again, can have coexisting angioedema. 35 to 50% of patients will actually have resolution of their symptoms within 1 year. So again, chronic urticaria may or may not occur with systemic illness. We generally try to avoid using immunoassays and skin testing as are generally not recommended in evaluation, because it doesn't help delineate the specific pathology. We're not exactly sure as to the pathologic mechanism of why this occurs, but we do see an inflammatory infiltrate in skin biopsies. We do know that in some patients there is autoantibody production, and we do know that there is mast cell and basophil dysfunction. When you see these patients, you want to make sure that you exclude any other differential diagnoses. If you see a patient with sole angioedema, that would take you down a different diagnostic algorithm. Again, if you were to see a patient who had urticaria that persisted for several days in a row, resolved with bruising and was primarily painful in nature as opposed to itchy, Again, that would take you down a different diagnostic algorithm. Again, when you see these patients, you want to assess for disease activity, how it's impacting patient quality of life and control, and you do want to identify triggers of possible exacerbation. So what is the pathophysiology? Again, I alluded to this, that there is mast cell and basophil dysfunction. We're not sure regarding the exact mechanism, but we do know that there is
Dr. Shams, we can't hear you now.
Oh, can you hear me now?
Yes, I can. Thank you.
Okay. My apologies. I'm not sure what happened.
Sometimes if you move a fair amount, sometimes that makes it hard to hear. So if you can just stay close to your microphone and we are excited to hear what you have to say.
Okay. So with release of these chemical mediators, we do see vasodilation, extravasation, and cellular infiltration, as well as sensory nerve activation. And this photo on the right side, shows that these mast cells can be triggered by a variety of different etiologies, causing release of these chemical mediators that again cause this inflammatory infiltrate to recruit into the skin tissue. So with urticaria, we do see that there's edema of the upper dermis, there's dilation and increased permeability of the postcapillary venules and lymph vessels, there's upregulation of cell adhesion molecules and growth factors, we see a mixed inflammatory infiltrate that we'll talk about in just a second, and this is very important. There is no vessel wall necrosis. If you were to biopsy these lesions and you see vessel wall necrosis, that is a hallmark for urticarial vasculitis. Again, that's a different diagnostic algorithm. Also, in non-lesional skin, we can see that these adhesion molecules are upregulated. There can be eosinophil infiltration as well as altered cytokine expression. We see a similar pathophysiology occurring in angioedema. It's just that these changes occur in the lower dermis and subcutis. So about 10% of patients actually have autoantibody production. So there's two different subtypes, type 1 and type 2. In type 1 autoimmunity, which you can see on the left side of this figure, you actually have IgE autoantibody to an autoantigen. So you can see that this IgE is targeting this autoantigen, and when it recognizes it, the mast cell degranulates and releases its chemicals. With omalizumab treatment, patients actually have a dramatic improvement in their symptoms within several days, as the drug binds free IgE autoantibodies and reduces the mast cell activation. In type 2 autoimmunity, you actually have an IgG and IgM autoantibody to either IgE or the IgE receptor. And as a result, again, you see the same mast cell degranulation. However, the difference is with omalizumab treatment, you actually see a slower response due to the slow loss of membrane-bound IgE and IgE receptor from skin mast cells. As far as the cellular infiltrate, we do see a inflammatory infiltrate in biopsy specimens of our urticaria patients, and this infiltrate is very similar to that of which is seen in late-phase allergic reactions. Most of the times, we actually do not need to have biopsies performed in our urticaria patients, but what we would see if we did biopsy their skin is an infiltration of lymphocytes, eosinophils, neutrophils, basophils, and macrophages. It's a little bit unclear if we actually see an increased density of mast cells in the skin tissue. Additionally, if we look at mRNA expression, in lesional skin, we'll actually see increased production of IL-4, IL-5, and interferon gamma in our urticaria patients, which is similar but distinct from what we see in a late-phase allergic reaction, where we have a Th2 cytokine profile with increased expression of IL-4 and IL-5. In regards to the cellular infiltrate, we really don't see any difference in patients with chronic urticaria that do or do not have autoantibody production. So as I mentioned before, we do know that there is innate mast cell and basophil dysfunction. we know that the mast cells in patients with urticaria, we do see an increase in total serum tryptase. This is in contrast to mature beta tryptase that we would see with an anaphylactic type reaction. And we know that the tryptase level is also higher in patients that have autoantibody versus those that don't. We also know that these mast cells also have an increased baseline tryptase production per mast cell. And these mast cells also have a hyper-releasing phenotype. We see an increased expression of the MRGPRX2 receptor, and that when it binds its ligands, we actually see increased histamine release, and we can also see non-IgE-mediated histamine release. We also know that the toll-like receptors on mast cells are acutely responsive to infectious stimuli, and this is why we often see exacerbations of urticaria during times of infection. In regards to beta pathophysiology, we see three distinct subtypes. So there's what we call CSU responders, where these patients actually have an intact histamine release upon IgE binding, and they'll release up to 10% of or more of their total histamine content. Generally, these patients have a longer disease course, but more mild disease. We also see CSU non-responders, where they have suppressed histamine release, and they release less than 10% of their total histamine content. And CSU basopenia patients, where they have less than 0.1% of peripheral blood cells are actually basophils. We know that in the CSU NR and basopenia patients, they generally have more severe disease, but it's generally of shorter duration. And with omalizumab treatment, we actually can improve this basopenia. And we think that the basopenia in the serum is actually related to recruitment of basophils to the skin. So if we can improve that, we think that's how the mechanism of how this works. There can be some associated eosinophil pathophysiology. You can see increased eosinophils in biopsy specimens. Patients sometimes do have eosinopenia, and eosinophil products may also activate the MRGX2 receptor. So you also want to evaluate with your patients, excuse me, whether this is an inducible or spontaneous phenomenon. Up to 20% of patients may have an inducible trigger, where an environmental stimulus may actually cause the inflammatory cells to degranulate. Patients may have several physical triggers that coexist, and this should be verified in the office so that we can better educate and identify these triggers, and so we can improve patient quality of life. A study done in Jackie in practice down in 2017 actually showed that 76% of patients reported a physical trigger, but only 36% had a positive challenge that was confirmed. The most common causes of inducible urticaria, and again confirmed by this study, were symptomatic dermatographism, cold-induced urticaria, as well as cholinergic urticaria. The response to these inducible triggers can range from mild to severe. And if patients do have severe episodes, they should also be prescribed an epinephrine autoinjector. Generally, patients with inducible urticaria are less responsive to standard treatment. In contrast, about 80% of patients with chronic urticaria have spontaneous development of urticaria, wheals, and angioedema. They may actually have both as well. So this chart goes through, it's from the practice parameters in 2014. It goes through the different subtypes of physical urticaria, the appropriate challenge procedure, and what a positive result would look like. I highlighted here at the bottom with some photos the three most common. So dermatographism is induced by stroking of the skin, and that simple stroking can cause urticaria. The middle picture is a photo of a positive ice cube test, which would confirm cold-induced urticaria, where application of an ice cube to the forearm for 5 minutes. Afterwards, passive rewarming of that site would actually lead to an urticarial reaction. And then on the right-hand side, you can see an example of cholinergic urticaria, where you see a very small, tiny urticarial lesion that's surrounded by a very large erythematous flare. So when you see these patients, you really want to target your workup based on your clinical suspicion, your history, and your exam. We try not to do an extensive workup unless it's necessary. So we would obtain complete blood cell count with differential. We would obtain inflammatory markers. Thyroid-stimulating hormone you can obtain if the patient has a history of thyroid disease or if they have active symptoms of thyroid dysfunction. But simply screening for thyroid dysfunction is generally thought to be low yield. Again, if you don't take anything else away from this presentation, we try to not do extensive testing for exogenous causes. Food, aeroallergens, that type of thing is generally not warranted because it's a totally different pathophysiology. The utility, we can test for autoantibodies, but the utility for testing for these really has not been well established, and it generally does not change our clinical management. We do, again, encourage you to challenge for a physical trigger if that is suspected based on the patient's history. So now that we know that our patient has chronic urticaria, how do we treat that? Well, in general, we want them to avoid triggers. That's step one. If there is a physical trigger, we want them to avoid it. We know that NSAIDs can exacerbate urticaria in up to a third of patients. So if that is a trigger, again, we'd have them avoid heat, extreme temperatures, tight clothing, all of that, again, can induce urticaria. So again, we would have patients avoid. Opiates can actually exacerbate urticaria through a non-IgE mediated phenomenon where the opiates actually bind to mast cells through the mu receptor. And alcohol similarly can also trigger urticarial flares. Generally, topical corticosteroids are of limited effect, especially if patients have diffuse involvement. They just would need so much topical corticosteroid to yield an improvement. It generally is not worth it. And we try to avoid using topical antihistamines because those agents have been reported to increase the risk of development allergic contact dermatitis. So when we start patients on medication, there generally is a step-up approach, kind of like a ladder. So we start at step one and we increase as needed. So step one is to use second generation antihistamines at FDA approved doses. If patients are feeling that, then we would step up to step two and use a higher dose second generation antihistamine. We may push the dose up to four times the FDA approved dose. We can consider adding first generation antihistamines or H2 antagonists or leukotriene receptor antagonists. If patients fail step two, then we would step up to step three, and we'd really push the dose of more potent first generation antihistamines such as doxepin and hydroxyzine. And lastly, if they fail that, then we would pursue other treatment with omalizumab and cyclosporin. These are the guidelines recommended by the American societies. There is a contrast to what's been reported in international guidelines. And the difference is step one and step two, for the most part, are the same. However, international guidelines really discourage against the use of first generation antihistamines, given their potent anticholinergic and sedative effects and impact on cognitive function. So in international guidelines, step three is really omalizumab, and step four is cyclosporin. I just want to make sure that the audience is aware of that. So when you start a patient on their therapy, you want them to follow up with you in 2 to 6 weeks to assess symptoms and treatment. And once urticaria is resolved, then we may further modify their treatment. As I said before, this disease generally persists for 2 to 5 years. We would not know if it had resolved unless we try to tweak patients' regimens and step them down after they achieved control. So if we go through each of these agents in a little bit more detail. So H1 antihistamines are the mainstays of therapy. We know that symptoms of urticaria are mediated by the histamine receptors on nerves and endothelial cells. Daily dosing is generally more effective in improving symptom control and quality of life than using just as needed doses when patients have urticaria. We can use first and second generation agents, and there really are very few comparative studies identifying a superior agent. In regards to H2 antihistamines, they're generally well tolerated and generally safe. However, there is some discrepancy on whether they're truly effective or not. Most of the studies that have demonstrated effect with using H2 antihistamines really has utilized cimetidine. There really have been a lot of conflicting reports with using ranitidine. So with cimetidine, the way in that it differs from ranitidine is that it inhibits the cytochrome P450 enzymes, which are required for metabolism of first-generation antihistamines. So when cimetidine and hydroxyzine were utilized together, the plasma concentration of hydroxyzine was higher, and there was an enhanced suppression of wheal and flare responses. A similar effect did not occur when cetirizine was used instead of hydroxyzine. And so this may actually be the explanation as to why H2 antagonists have been proven effective in the past. Again, they're relatively safe and relatively well tolerated, so it's up to the physician's discretion. And it's in regards to leukotriene receptor antagonists, again, they too are generally well tolerated, yet they do have a recent FDA black box warning for depression and suicidal ideation. There is a possible role of leukotrienes in some. And so if that's the case, patients may have a beneficial response in several weeks. Predictors of response include if patients have NSAID-induced urticaria, we know that's a sign of overproduction of prostaglandins and leukotrienes. If patients have a shorter duration of urticaria, if they have if they're younger age at onset, and if their urticaria is aggravated by antihistamines. As far as oral glucocorticoids, we know that short-term use is very efficacious in patients with urticaria. However, we generally discourage against long-term use. With short-term use, patients have a good effect. They can have some associated side effects, such as mood changes, gastric upset, increased blood sugar, weight gain, but we generally don't see the same effects as long-term use. We generally don't see effect on the hypothalamic pituitary axis or osteoporosis, that type of thing. If patients are starting on oral steroids, we do want to be cognizant that we monitor their response to therapy, we assess for any of these side effects, and that we also are keeping an eye on comorbid disease that can be exacerbated by oral steroids. So step four, so if patients have failed the three previous steps, then we would consider omalizumab therapy. So omalizumab actually is FDA approved at two different doses for use in chronic urticaria. It has very limited side effects. It is a recombinant humanized monoclonal antibody that binds to free IgE and inhibits binding of IgE to the IgE receptor. And subsequently we get decreased receptors on mast cell and basophil surfaces. We have a lot of efficacious data for asthma, but it's only been recently, in the last 10 years, approved for omalizumab for chronic urticaria. The mechanism of action is unclear, but we know that it does have an impact on basophil function and it can improve basopenia. It is more effective in patients without autoantibodies or with low total IgE. There are several case reports and case series that also suggest efficacy in a variety of different physical subtypes, but there's really no validated biomarker that can predict an effective response. So this is one schematic from one of the phase 3 pivotal trials involving omalizumab approval. There were 323 subjects that were enrolled with refractory urticaria, and they were treated with three different doses of omalizumab at 4-week intervals. There was a slightly higher report of adverse effects in those with the highest dose, but if you can see, the yellow line with hatches is actually omalizumab 300 milligram dose. You can see that the itch severity score improved dramatically in those patients in comparison to placebo. Additionally, there was also dramatic improvement in the 150 milligram group. Upon resolution or completion of the study, most of the patients actually had recurrence of urticaria. This is another schematic showing very similar data from one of the other pivotal trials involving omalizumab approval. Again, these patients were treated with omalizumab 300 milligrams versus placebo every 4 weeks. And you can see that the y-axis is itch severity score improvement. You can see that in comparison of the 300 milligram group and the placebo, there's a dramatic improvement. So if patients fail omalizumab, then we generally would prefer or start them on cyclosporin. Cyclosporin does have some, does require cautious use. It does downregulate Th1 responses, and we think through that it also inhibits mast cell and basophil mediator release. However, we're not really sure, one, regarding the optimal duration of therapy. Two, we know that there are some important differences in bioavailability between different brands, so we need to be aware of that. And we need to keep a close eye on our patients for the development of side effects and adverse effects. So when patients were randomized to cyclosporin versus cetirizine, those that were on cyclosporin had a significant improvement in their symptom scores, but they also had a higher rate of significant side effects. So that is the word of caution with use of cyclosporine. If patients fail both of those therapies, then we really need to consider alternative agents. With using any additional agents, there really is very limited evidence, which is mostly restricted to case reports. And so you want to make sure that the benefit and the risk are balanced. People have utilized dapsone, sulfasalazine, hydroxychloroquine, tacrolimus, and mycophenolate. I included this table, which also is from the practice parameters in 2014, which lists a variety of different medication, but also baseline laboratory tests that would need to be obtained prior to starting patients on these medications, and then what would need to be continued throughout their duration of treatment. So what do we do about special populations? So pregnancy and lactation. If we are seeing pregnant and lactating women with chronic urticaria, which does occur, what do? We generally try to follow the same treatment approach, but utilize antihistamines at the lowest effective dose. Second generation antihistamines really have no reports of associated birth defect. And we generally would prefer either loratadine or cetirizine or their associated derivatives. First generation antihistamines are excreted in breast milk in low concentration. They can cause neonatal sedation. So we generally would recommend that women wait several hours after taking their medication before they breastfeed. In regards to oral glucocorticoids, they have been used in a variety of different inflammatory diseases in pregnancy, but we do know that they can have some associated effects on the pregnancy as well as on neonatal development. Low levels, again, can be expressed in breast milk. And so, again, we want to make sure that women, if they are able to separate their medication by several hours before they breastfeed. And with using those agents during pregnancy and breastfeeding, we want to make sure that the benefit should outweigh the risk. We also have some data regarding the use of omalizumab in pregnancy. So Cuervo Pardo reported a case series of four patients that had refractory urticaria treated with omalizumab 300 milligrams every 4 weeks and did exceptionally well. There was no report of any associated teratogenicity or pregnancy complication. Gampazar also reported a patient who actually was pregnant twice, during both pregnancies was treated with omalizumab. And we know from the expect pregnancy registry using asthma patients or patients with asthma on omalizumab, we really know that the prevalence of associated teratogenic effects was similar to that of the general population. In elderly patients, again, we want to use a similar treatment approach, but we need to be more careful about antihistamines and monitoring them. We want to make sure we're aware of disease comorbidity that can be complicated by using antihistamines, polypharmacy. If patients have kidney or liver insufficiency, we may need to modify their dose. And in 2012, the American Geriatric Society updated their criteria, their BERS criteria, and listed first-generation antihistamines as potentially inappropriate medications, given their risk of anticholinergic effects, sedation, and cognitive impairment. So what new treatments are on the horizon? Well, we have ligelizumab, which there was a recent publication regarding this. Ligelizumab is a high affinity humanized IgG1-2 IgE. If you compare this agent to omalizumab, there's actually a 40 to 50% greater affinity and a rapid onset of action. This is a schematic from one of their phase 2b trial, and you can see that in each of the higher or increasing ligelizumab doses, there was a significant improvement in the weekly hive severity score. They also compared these patients with omalizumab, and again, was statistically significantly more effective, as well as in placebo patients. In regards to dupilumab, Lee and Simpson recently reported a case series of six patients that had refractory urticaria and failed high-dose omalizumab. They were successful with using dupilumab at a 600-milligram loading dose and 300 milligrams every 2 weeks, with urticaria resolving within 3 months. There's actually ongoing trials evaluating efficacy of use. Also is AZD1981, which is a selective and reversible CRTH2 antagonist. CRTH2 is a cell marker on a variety of different cells, including TH2 cells, eosinophils, and basophils. So by targeting this molecule, we actually inhibit chemotaxis. There was a phase 2 trial for antihistamine-resistant urticaria patients that showed a statistically significant improvement in the urticaria activity score after 4 weeks. Other agents that are undergoing the investigation involve anti-IL-5 agents, including rezolizumab, mepolizumab, and benralizumab. We're not sure exactly regarding the specific role in urticaria, and so far the data is really limited to case reports. Bruton tyrosine kinase inhibitors inhibit the signaling molecule involved in mast cell and B cell activation. So there are ongoing studies involving two specific agents, as well as a humanized monoclonal antibody to Siglec-8. Siglec-8 is present on the surface of mast cells, eosinophils, and basophils. So if we inhibit their activity, again, the thought is that we should be able to improve urticaria. So this includes some areas for further research. We need more data regarding our patients that do have urticaria. We need to know more about activating factors, histological markers, biomarkers of urticaria activity and mast cell activation, which patients would be most successful with different therapies. We need to clarify the role of autoantibodies. We need to further evaluate the impact this has on comorbid disease as well as patients' underlying well-being. We need to understand what the mechanisms are in antihistamine-resistant urticaria and angioedema, as well as the long-term safety profile for many of our medications available. So the take-home messages today are that acute and chronic urticaria differ by cause and subsequent evaluation. Treatment follows a step up or ladder approach. If we do fail these therapies, then we do need to seek out further treatment with immune modulators and possibly immune suppressants. There are many up and coming medications on the horizon. And patients with special populations, including pregnancy, lactation, and elderly, we generally utilize similar management, but we need to be more cognizant of associated effects of medication. So with that, I'm going to open it up to questions.
Oh, thank you so much, Dr. Shams. I learned so much while I was listening to you. We do have several questions that have already been written in. And the first one is, do you have a suggestion for relief of itching other than Benadryl, something that wouldn't cause as much drowsiness?
Well, that's a great question. I guess I would need a little bit more clarity. Are we talking more about a topical preparation or an oral preparation? If we're speaking of an oral medication, again, if itching is mediated by histamine, generally we would prefer second generation antihistamine agents. They have a longer duration of action, they're less sedating, and they have less side effects. So loratadine, cetirizine, or their associated derivatives would be my preferred option. If we're talking about topical agents, again, topical Benadryl, we generally try and shy away from that because it can increase the risk of allergic contact dermatitis. If patients have localized urticaria, they may have some benefit with topical steroids. But again, if they're covered head to toe, they have a diffuse presentation, topical steroids are likely going to be of limited benefit.
Thank you so much. The next question is more of a webinar question, so I'll quick answer this one. The question is, will the PowerPoint be available to save or review after the webinar? And because this is offered for CE, we do not publish the webinar slides. However, it will be recorded so that if there's something you need to review, you can certainly view the recording. Okay, so the next question is, how do you approach the patient with chronic urticaria who demands a large food panel testing without appropriate clinical history? I find this to be the most difficult. Any tips or phrases that help?
So I definitely feel this audience member's frustration. This is a constant struggle. And I think at the end of the day, it all comes back to education. If you share with your patient why it most likely is not a food allergy, that this is not the pathology that we see in chronic urticaria patients, I think education and it telling them and educating them, that goes a long way. I do have patients that come into the office and they think they're allergic to 52 different foods and it's everything that they're eating. And but really, they don't understand, they don't have the same education that we have as to the pathophysiology of what is actually happening with chronic urticaria, what's happening on the cellular level, what's happening with these different mechanisms that have been proposed. So I think if we educate patients, I think that goes a long way, and that generally has helped to ease the frustration, and patients actually feel more empowered that they understand what's going on, why they're having these manifestations, instead of hearing from their friends and family members, oh, you must be allergic to a million different foods, that type of thing.
Okay, thank you. Now, is this a condition that would be seen in children in the school setting?
Yes, so actually we do see that there are quite a few pediatric patients that also have chronic urticaria. And we're getting more prevalence data. Some recent articles have suggested that at extremes of age, both in pediatric populations and in patients with advanced age, we can see higher prevalence rates of urticaria. So yes, it can occur in patients, in pediatric patients. One word of caution is, if you do see a pediatric patient, be very mindful that we are doing our due diligence in obtaining history, that we are excluding food allergies, that type of thing, just as we would with any other patient. But we just want to make sure that we're not missing anything, because in those patients, we don't want to miss a food allergy.
Okay, thank you. The next question says, are autoantibodies in just 10% of patients or in 90% of patients?
So at this point in time, the data that we have shows that autoantibodies can be prevalent in 10% of patients. In the other 90% of patients, at this point in time, we don't know exactly what the underlying mechanism is or if they have autoantibodies to different antigens that we have not assessed yet.
Okay, next question is, why do both ased rate and CRP?
That is a great question. And part of that comes back to the fact that we want to make sure that we're excluding possible other etiologies. So if you saw a patient that had an increased sedimentation rate and or CRP, that's a marker of underlying inflammation and would generally prompt you down to evaluating for other causes. We did not have time in this webinar to go through all the differential for chronic urticaria, but one of the most striking would be urticarial vasculitis. Again, that would come to mind if patients had painful urticaria, urticaria with bruising, and if we saw an increase in the inflammatory markers.
Okay, thank you. Are there any effects of high-dose antihistamine on cardiac rhythms?
That is also a great question. So we have to make sure that we are talking specifically about either first generation or second generation agents. Second generation agents, specifically hydroxyzine, I believe can actually cause issues with cardiac morbidity. It can increase the QT interval. So that again is another reason for why we really want to make sure if we're putting a patient on that we balance the risk and benefit. With second generation agents, again, loratadine, cetirizine, levocetirizine, those type agents, we generally don't see a risk associated with cardiac issues. And we do oftentimes push the dose. But again, first generation agents, yes, I would be careful if somebody does have an underlying cardiac history.
Thank you so much. But what is the duration of using omalizumab?
So that too is a great question. Generally, as far as all of these treatments, we want to treat patients until we have resolution of urticaria. So generally, we put patients on medications and we would not stop or decrease the dose of their medication until they have been symptom-free for at least 6 to 12 months. After that, if patients do have good resolution and control of their urticaria, we may consider modification of their omalizumab dose or changing the dose interval. Again, the disease generally resolves anywhere from 2 to 5 years. So we constantly are tweaking patients' medications based on their control. And if they are doing well, we will cut their dose down or space out their interval, there at this point in time, there really is not a suggested duration of therapy or maximum duration of therapy where if you go beyond this number of years of treatment, you could have these effects. We really have not seen that in our asthma patients where we have them on omalizumab generally indefinitely. So we don't think that's the case in urticaria, but we do need more studies to evaluate that.
Okay, thank you. Well, our next question is, have you had any success with omalizumab in solar urticaria? I have one patient on samples. They're getting better slowly, but I'm fighting an external review for insurance coverage.
Wow. To answer that question shortly, no, I do. Solar urticaria is extremely rare, less than 1% of all physical urticaria. So I really commend this physician or provider for starting their patient on omalizumab for this. I'm glad to hear that the patient has had some improvement. Unfortunately, lots of times when patients are with, you know, beyond that typical protocol that they have classically defined chronic spontaneous urticaria, or they failed other treatments, providers really do have to navigate in order to do what's best for their patients. So I commend you, and I hope to hear that they do well. And if so, you can publish this case report.
There you go. Okay, someone is asking, are there any trials that have been done with diet modifications?
I am not aware of any trials utilizing dietary modifications in the United States. I think in some of the international guidelines, there is some mention of that. Generally, with dietary modification, I would need to know a little bit more about what this person is referring to, but generally, there's not a whole lot of success with dietary modification. Sometimes patients will come into the office and say, if I just eliminate these histamine containing foods, will my urticaria go away? And again, that's generally not the pathology. It's not due to ingested histamine most of the time. So generally that doesn't have an effect. Lots of times patients will empirically avoid the most common food allergens. And again, this is generally not a food allergy. So avoiding peanuts, you know, generally they don't notice any improvement. And to go back to that, the first question regarding how do you counsel patients so that you don't end up doing extensive food panels? That's one of the items I do ask patients is, if you've avoided this food, do you still have urticaria? And if the answer is yes, then it's, you know, the answer is then it's not that specific food. So oftentimes that will help as well.
Sounds good. Okay, the next question is epinephrine indicated for all cases of angioedema?
No, I don't think so. If the patient has had a history of recurrent angioedema, laryngeal angioedema, without any urticaria, I think we're talking about a different pathologic mechanism. If we are referring to a patient who also has coexisting urticaria that's due to either an acute trigger or they have a physical trigger that can induce severe episodes of angioedema, then that may be. But I think we really need to evaluate the patients on a case-by-case basis. Just because they have urticaria and angioedema, they don't necessarily need to have a prescription for an epinephrine autoinjector. Lots of times patients will feel more comfortable by having that prescription. And if that's the case, oftentimes we will give it to them. But just because you have chronic urticaria and angioedema you do not necessarily require an EpiPen or an epinephrine autoinjector. My apologies. And so for most patients, we generally do not have them have that. This is not an anaphylactic reaction. So generally epinephrine is of, you know, limited utility. Generally, we try to start patients on the treatment regimens I mentioned earlier.
Okay, great. Someone's asking, when working in a school setting, our options are topical Benadryl or hydrocortisone cream. What is your recommendation?
I mean, in that situation, in the school setting, someone is itchy, they have a few urticarial lesions. Again, we need to kind of assess what's going on. Is this a new onset food allergy? But generally, if we're talking about topical antihistamines versus topical hydrocortisone, I would say topical hydrocortisone. It's going to be more effective, and it is not going to be associated with that same concern for allergic contact dermatitis. If you use the topical antihistamine sparingly, it may be okay, but we don't want to exchange one issue for another.
That sounds very sensible. Okay, next question is, do you do thyroid function usually in your patients to look at hypothyroidism?
I generally do not do screening assessments of a TSH or thyroid panel. If patients do have a history of thyroid disease or their medications have recently been adjusted and there is a time association, a correlation with this episode of urticarial angioedema, then yes, I will check it. Or if they're endorsing symptoms of active thyroid disease, they're reporting hair loss, weight gain or weight loss, those types of, or temperature instability. Then in that case, yes, again, I will check a TSH, but as for a general screening, try to keep it limited. It generally is not going to be that helpful.
Okay, is there a relationship between stress and urticaria?
Absolutely. So we do oftentimes know that when patients are during a time period of acute stress or infection, that can manifest with an increase or worsening of urticaria. The way that I describe it to my patients is that your mast cells are part of your immune system. And so if your immune system is involved in a stress-related event, whether that's emotional or physical, like trauma or infection, then the mast cells can also be activated. So oftentimes, if we have patients that have done great with urticaria, they've been hive-free for several months, and all of a sudden they have an acute flare, that's what we're going to be asking them about. Is there a recent stressful event in your life? Was there a infection during this time? Did you have some type of physical trauma, that type of thing?
Okay, the next question is another kind of webinar question. Someone's asking that they missed how to print out the handout certificate. If you look on your control panel, you'll find the handouts pane. And if you go to there, you'll find the certificate. If you download that now and print that out, that's great, because we're going to be only able to take two more questions. And at the end of the webinar, you won't be able to get the certificate. But if you have any trouble, email me and I'll get you a certificate. No problem. Okay, next question is, what do you look at when taking a patient history to determine between food allergy and chronic urticaria?
So again, you would ask the same type of questions as you would for any food allergy patients. Have you noticed this in relationship to a specific food? What point in time after you ingested that food did you start having symptoms? Do you only have urticaria in association with this food, or can it happen at other times too? So you want to make sure that if it is a food allergy, the urticaria should always occur in association with consumption of that food. And generally with food allergy, we will see reactions occurring within a 2-hour period. So if a patient says, I had this food for dinner and then 2 days later I broke out in urticaria, that's generally not an associated cause.
Okay, and our last question is, can a vaccine trigger urticaria?
That is a great question. I think that kind of comes back to the fact that it can be induced from stress. So perhaps that's part of it. Again, we would want to make sure that we'd want to know how long after this vaccine did the patient have urticaria. So was it with that they got a vaccine and then within 30 minutes they developed urticaria and then several days later it was gone? If that's the case, if it's a relatively soon onset after the vaccine and it's not a significant duration, we want to make sure that we're not missing vaccine-related allergy or possible latex that can be in vaccine or other ingredients that can be in vaccines.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Dr. Shams. This has been just fabulous, and I appreciate you taking so much time for questions.
Thank you. I appreciate all the wonderful questions.
Oh, that's great. Okay, so we'd like to invite you to join us next month for our April webinar when Dr. Jay Lieberman will present on the latest in food allergy diagnosis. This webinar will air on Thursday, April 23rd at 4 p.m. Eastern. You can register for this webinar on our website at allergyasthmanetwork.org. Look for education in the horizontal navigation bar near the top of the page and scroll to webinars. You can also view our archived webinars on this page on our website. Visit our website for quality guidelines-based resources on allergy and asthma. Also, access important medical information on allergies and asthma from our partners, the American College of Allergy, Asthma, and Immunology at allergyandasthmarelief.org. Thank you again for joining us, and we look forward to having you register to be with us next time on Advances in Allergy and Asthma. This is Sally Schessler for the staff at Allergy and Asthma Network. We hope you have a great and a healthy day as we work to breathe better together.